want students to classify, and I see that in the classroom. We want students to sort, and I see that in the classroom too as well. So we're doing pretty good with level two, but we do need to add a little bit more. You want to go on to the next one? So what does level two look like in a real classroom? So the next slide we have, and I believe Amanda, we had this in level one. So for level two, we have, of course, the verb, we have the teacher role, and the student role. So I know in Amanda's presentation, she wanted y'all to think with y'all's group member and to, you know, to talk about it and let's share out. But I want you to look at this. I want to give y'all some time to look at the verb, to look at the teacher role, and to look at the student's role. But then I'm also going to have you do something, the next step, right? So on your table, you have this white sheet of paper. What I'm gonna have you do is for you to write, to summarize what you think, what you see, in reference to the teacher's role, the student's role. Very simple. I want you to write, okay? I'm gonna give you like maybe 2 minutes or so for you to, maybe, yeah, 2 minutes is fine. 2 minutes for you to think about this here, and I want you to think of you know, what you see on that particular table. Does everyone have a white sheet? Are we okay with paper?
Is it one white sheet per person?
Just one white sheet per person. Yes. I'm so sorry. Here we go. Yes. Then that's the thing. Yes. Look at the teacher's role, look at the student's role in the verb. The last activity that we did, we were sharing with our partner. What did you see? What do you think? And all I ask is for you to write down your thoughts. I'm gonna give you like 2 minutes.
You what?
The power. 2 minutes. It's already up. Finish your last sentence. this is good, this is good. I'm seeing rain, right? This is something that we need here at ET Ren, definitely for sure, with our students. What I want you to do, okay, because I know that we went over level one, now we're focusing on level two. All I asked is for you to look at the teacher's role and the student's role, but I want you to write up what are your thoughts, okay? What are your thoughts? That's basically it. So I'm going to ask y'all to do something because I think we kind of need to move around because that was really cool what we did just a few minutes ago because now my heart is pumping and all that good stuff. So can I have y'all stand up for a second, please? And can we form like a nice circle? Can we form a circle, please? Get your paper too.
Questions to differentiate, check for knowledge, explore connections. and students create models to show relationships, uses conceptual knowledge, level one, to answer questions.
Okay, very good, very good, very good. Alejandro, what do you have on your page?
I have graphic organizers, predict, visual vocabulary, reflect, and journal.
Journal, okay, all right. All right, I need some language arts teacher. Ms. Green? Is it Green?
Yes. Yeah. Huh. Okay, predict, summarize, make observations, cause and effect.
There you go. Predict, summarize, and cause and effect, right? Is that what you have?
Yes.
Very good.
Make observations.
Okay. So this is something where, you know what, in order for us to check for students' understanding, you can definitely do this in your classroom. I've done this a couple of times. Ruben, you've done this too as well, whenever you had students in the classroom. And this is something fun because you know why? Number one, they have to write. And you know what? And I gathered this info from Leap Forward. And it says a 1 minute summary. And I thought, you know what? Some of these kids, they don't need 1 minute. I think probably they need two or three, you know, for them to write something. And you can also utilize this as an exit ticket, just heads up on that. So you can go ahead and check everyone's work after they happen to leave your class. You want to say something, sir?
Sure. One thing I like, when I use this activity, I like to start them off with a sentence then. Now, I know what she did, you know, she kind of had y'all just start off by writing. You know, you guys are adult learners.
That's
but
right.
with our students, you know, one of our ways to kind of get them to thinking, particularly using the sentence stems that are only four, so you can get them to think the way you want them to think, you know, kind of incorporate a stem that guides their thinking, and then give them that stem, then they start writing, and then it kind of, you know, gets them going, and then they, you know, chuck and chug. But I talk about an engaging activity, very engaging.
Very engaging. Yes, sir.
No, I'd like to make a confession. before you were giving the instructions of this lesson,
yes.
I was thinking about the this, that, how I can incorporate that in my class.
Yes.
And then next thing I heard you say was write. I'm like, what do you mean write? And so, like, I guess for a second there, I was able to put myself in a student's shoes sometimes where they might not always be focused and engaged sometimes when I tell them to do something. Mm-hmm. And so then I had to get secondhand information about how to write, and then what I wrote, I feel, isn't as up to par as the other things that other people wrote. So,
no.
I'm saying
that's that
goes to the
so
hand.
The sentence stem will be helpful for those types of.
The sentence stem will be helpful, and that's something that I've kind of come across too. Like, kid will get a paper and they're like, oh my God, what did this kid say? Like, you know, so, you know, I think a sentence stem really helps, you know.
But it helps them to feel that bit of anxiety of, I need to pay attention, I need to perform, now what do I do?
Yeah. You know, and I think too, especially our special population, our spec ed and our ELL, we want them to write. And having those sentence stems, you know, being used in the classroom every day to help them is going to definitely ensure that there is academic success in the classroom.
There's also, if you don't have the Leap Forward app on your iPad or your school iPad, make sure you have that because it has stems on there that you can put, and a lot of people have the cognitive Spanish, which I know that doesn't help our African kids. But it can help a lot of our ELLs that we have as a majority of
And so I'm glad you brought that up. I mean, you're being honest too, because the fact that, you know what, earlier we were think pair and we were talking things out and et cetera. I wanted to do something different.
No.
You know what, we have to write it out now. And that's the next step for level two. It's all about writing, okay? And I thought this is really cool because you know what, some kids might get embarrassed at what they have on their paper, that if you happen to call them out, I'm gonna read it. You know what, we're gonna go ahead and have some type of snowball, right? And I appreciate y'all, you know, being cool with it because, you know, like Ruben said, we don't want them to be throwing the ball, maybe more like tossing it, you know. And I believe I saw at one location where they had like kind of like a center point, so they kind of need to like toss it to the center point or something like that. But it's really, really fun, but it has to be controlled. It really does. Yes, ma'am.
I was going to say with the sentence stems, also communicating that the kids don't have to use them. So I have some kids that are pre-AP and they have more trouble trying to fit their thoughts and creative imagination into a sentence stem.
That's right.
And so kind of communicating. You can use the sentence stem if you want to, but if you don't,
because
there's sometimes where kids come up with something like,
yeah.
Dang, that's awesome.
Yeah.
But that's not for me, it's from their own imagination.
That's right,
so.
That's right. Perfect, well said. Yeah. All right, yes ma'am.
Oh, cheer. If you just have them granny toss, instead of say you can't throw it overhand.
Oh, I like the granny toss.
And you won't get hit in the face.
They
And just make sure you give clear directions because I know that we had someone here. Am I going to say any names at all whatsoever? It's on the right. And so totally tossed it out. But you have to make sure you're very clear. And it depends on your classroom too. But the reason why I wanted y'all to come in a circle is for us to understand teacher's role is to model examples and not examples. The teacher's role is to check for conceptual understanding. We should always check for understanding. Every single day, we should always check. Right? Yes?
Yes.
Peace and love, right?
All yes, the good yes. ones check for understanding all the time.
Always, always, always. All right, guys, what I want you to do right now, we're going to go back to the PowerPoint. I want you to leave your, hold on to the paper, that's fine. Just put it onto it. I want to use it as an exit statement whenever we leave for lunch. Yes. Okay, guys, we're going to go on to the next section here. Possible products here. Just go on to the next one, please. Possible products here. I see this as evidence of learning. Evidence of learning. Okay, some products that I see here, caption photo summary. Okay, maybe there's some type of a photo where they have to write some type of a summary. Timeline. I see that in social studies. I see that in science. I may see that in language arts and all content. Demonstrations. Students have to demonstrate, okay? I see a lot of graphic organizers here at ET RIP. And I'm glad that we are organizing the students' thoughts. They need organizations, definitely, for sure. Okay? I'm also seeing, too, a lot. I know in science we have a lot. And usually it's kind of like an ABBA strategy where at the end of the lesson they have to write what they have learned. Okay? In class. Okay? These are possible products that you may use in the classroom. I call this here evidence of learning from Lead Forward. Okay? Go on to the next one. Possible activities that you may use in your classroom. Pretty cool. Sequence a key chain of events in a timeline, flow chart, or an outline. Write a summary. Write a summary. Or information or report using supporting details. And I know that Ms. Sodi and I, we were talking about that just a few minutes ago because we're looking in our next unit for body systems. And so we're already planning like some type of writing for all of the classes that maybe pre-AP will have this, so we can try to differentiate the instruction with pre-AP and with our regular ed students. Explain a series of steps used to find a solution. That's in all content, maybe more in math, maybe in science, maybe in social studies. I don't know. I'm just thinking. Depends on the activities, right?
Yeah.
Demonstrate how to perform a particular task. Complex calculation, you have math right there. Create a questionnaire or survey, okay, and conduct measurement. Do you want to say something?
Sure, one thing I want to add here, because I know I push in all content areas, but particularly in social studies, in math and science, because our content is very sequential, you know, linear, we want to really hone in on that backwards design planning, because a lot of our performance tasks and assessments that are in our TEKS resource system are at the level 2 and the level 3, okay? So we really want to look at the possible activities, I know they're here, that are going to get our kids to success, towards success on those PAs, right? What are we doing in our daily lessons that are going to guide them towards success on that performance task, where they show us that they understood the content that we taught, okay? So that's very important. And it all depends on the task, you know? I just wanted to add
No, it really does, because I'm glad you brought up TEKS resource and in reference to the performance assessment, because every content is doing PAs.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of the PAs, there's a lot of like their steps, their summarization, they have to write something. So, I mean, I'm glad that we're using the PAs because we want our students to be doing this, but we shouldn't have them do it until the end of the PA. They should always be doing some type of writing so they can be prepared.
Yeah.
You see what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, and
Yeah.
And there's a lot of confusion sometimes in regards to like, oh, well, I want to see the multiple choice test. You know, and it's important that we look at that, you know, particularly like what's been tested before. So we see that transfer of knowledge occurring, particularly with the different stimulus they were gonna embed in our content areas, but we really wanna hone in on those PAs, because they're super, super, super important for us to, for our kids to provide evidence of their learning.
Okay, go on
to
the next one, please, thank you. Then we have possible questions, guys, that we can definitely ask. How or why would you use this information, et cetera, and et cetera? What examples can you find to explain the difference of, you know, so then you would have to add more to the question. Again, these are like some type of sentence stems that you can utilize. I was very happy that I know for a fact that a lot of y'all have this already, and I will totally use this in the classroom or to help you to, to create these questions here. Again, we're looking at possible questions for level two. I know for like the third one, it says, how would you organize? And I'm gonna go ahead and use what we're studying, the periodic table, to show trends, you know? And that's something that's part of the standard. That's what it says exactly. So I think it's crucial that we ask those type of questions here, and I think this is something great, okay? Any questions about what summarizes? You wanna go on to the next one, please? Okay, now you have this object, yay, this one here. So what we like for you to do, just how we did it the very first one here, is for you to develop a level two question. Develop a level two question, okay? And the same format, we're gonna go ahead and post those questions onto the post-it here. So think of level two questions. You do happen to have this particular handout, these sentence stems, to help you develop those questions. Going to give you 2 minutes or so.
So I'm thinking like how could you either classify or compare and contrast this shape from say another three-dimensional form? Or you could even take two or three forms and figure out how would you classify them.
There you go.
You know?
Oh, you're sweet. I hate sitting down.
Yes, I'm gonna check. Yes, okay. This is good.
I think the fraction just fruit.
Do we have 1, 2, 3, 4?
And I told them before, I was like,
how you doing? I'm Ruben Pearson.
Yeah, I remember you. Remember from the sixth grade.
This probably didn't seem your mic to me, but I was like, I didn't know what I was doing.
Oh, you're just starting
out. Well, I know that. Okay. We're going to go ahead and review the questions, guys. Do we have everyone's questions, that table here? Do we have y'all's table? Okay, so ready? Okay, that's fine.
But then
it's coming right now.
All right. Very cool. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. Okay. I'm gonna go over question number two, same format, thumbs up, thumbs down, but I have this one here. It says. No, it says Matthew Ortiz wants to know, could you make a circle out of the components? Yay or nay?
Nay.
Is that a thumbs up?
I know.
It's
a yes or no?
It's a good question. I know. It's okay. Thank you. Yes. Thank you for noticing that. All right. All right. Ringing hammer. It's okay. And the next one here. How would you apply what you learned to develop a perspective drawing? How would you apply what you learned to develop a perspective drawing? How would you apply what you learned? Oh, yeah, she used the sentence stems. This is perfect. Thank you so much. Very good, very good. Okay.
Right there.
Okay, now we're going back, so this perspective drawing. Okay, we're going back to the actual model here. Compare and contrast this shape to a cube. Compare and contrast this shape to a cube. Yay? Or thumbs up? Yes, yes, this is good. I like this question. Oh, this is, okay, I'm going to point this up. This is a good one. Again, how would you classify the object in comparison to the to other 3D forms? Yeah, yeah. How would you classify this object, right? Very good. Thank you. Thumbs up. And then our last one. If the shape is dilated, right, by a scale factor of S,
By five.
I'm so sorry. By five. What is the difference in volume between the original and the new 3D shape?
You're just asking the similarities and differences.
If they had said, compared, what is the ratio? How is it impacted?
Yes, that would be.
That would be by a scale factor of five. If volume, that would be.
So, again, if the shape is dilated by a scale, right, the factor of five, what is the difference in the volume between the original and new 3D shape? So it's pretty good. What do you think?
Two.
Okay. I heard someone saying a three. All right, guys. Guys, you know what? Thank you so very much. I just hope that we understand the difference between a one and a two. Right now, are we going to take a little
brain break?
We're actually going to give you a 5-minute break.
Okay.
But please don't be late because I'm actually late for lunch.
Yeah. Okay.
So we're going to, instead of the brain break, we're going to give you a 5-minute break to go in.
Do you have a timer on? Thanks. Okay.